If you've had any cryptid encounters that you'd like me to share on here, email me at jttosstories@gmail.com. Story 1. My brother and I have a story that happened during the day, and we're both positive that what we saw was a skinwalker. Here's what happened. We were staying in Wenatchee in Washington State. It's kind of Eastern, but not really. Like, it wants to be Eastern, but it's not. Anyway, we were staying with my friend's family, whilst my parents were out of state. My friend's mom, I'll call her Tammy, says to me, "Will you get your brother? Dinner's ready." To which I replied, "Where is he?" My friend, I'll call her Emily, goes, "I think he's down by the river." I said, "Okay," and went to go get him. I crossed the backyard, which really is a field, and prepared myself to go down a stupidly steep hill. The only way to get down the hill was to keep your foot planted on some rocks. It's either that or fly down. I got down the hill and saw my brother just chilling on a swing thing. You know, the swings with two or three seats on them? Those things. I stood behind for a minute, planning to push the swing a little and scare him, but I heard my name being called. So naturally, I turned around, thinking it was Emily calling me or something. No one on the field. I had, and still have, a pretty active imagination, so I just brushed it off. I turned back to the swing, and my brother was standing up now. His eyes were fixed across the river, so I looked over too. We saw a deer-looking thing standing on its back legs, and I, again, was just like, oh, it's my imagination. I looked away for a few seconds, then turned back. My brother was now shaking. He still hadn't noticed me. The deer guy was still there, but its mouth was moving. It was saying my name. I could just barely make it out, but it was saying my name. I started to shake as well. My brother turned around, ready to run back to the house, and yelled when he saw me. This was the following conversation between us. What happened? Me. Him. Did you see it too? Me. The deer? Him. It was not a deer. I don't know what that thing was, but it was not a deer. Me. Was it calling my name to you? Him. No. It was calling my name. Me. We can talk about it later. But I was sent to get you 5 minutes ago. Dinner's ready. And I know I said I have a very active imagination, but the part that scares me is that my brother does not. And he saw exactly what I saw. And so we went inside and ate dinner, and said nothing of it. We had both relaxed, for the most part, by the time we got back to the house, and we texted each other about it after, so that way no one would know but us. About a year after the happening, my brother came into my room and said, "Hey, remember that deer thing we saw in Wenatchee a few years back?" I told him I thought about it frequently, and what he said actually scared me so badly I thought I was gonna go into cardiac arrest. He goes, "Well, I've done some major research, and we could have died if we went near it. Turns out it was a skinwalker." And he continued to tell me about skinwalkers and what they do. I'm not getting into it, but every now and again, we both share a look when someone starts talking about stuff like Wendigos and skinwalkers, urban legends, and creepypasta, stuff like that. And neither of us have really said anything about it. My brother decided to tell my dad, who grew up with urban legends and stuff like that, and he also thinks that it was a skinwalker. I can still see that evil thing's face every time I hear about Wendigo and skinwalker encounters. My brother got a kind of mental effect from this thing, too. I don't want to say it's like PTSD, but certain things around the topic trigger him. He'll constantly have nightmares about it, and he doesn't like talking about it unless he initiates the conversation. I'm a little more thick-skinned around the topic of scary things, but it scares me into thinking I was going to die on that spot. We haven't been back to Wenatchee. Story 2. So this was the summer of 2012. I was 15 years old. I had my first job as a counselor in training at a fly fishing camp for kids at Antelope Creek Ranch, which is around the backside of Mount Shasta in California. I had attended the camp for several summers in my youth, and this was the first, or maybe second year, I had returned as a CIT, since I wasn't old enough to be a counselor yet. There was one other CIT with me who was around my same age, as well as several older counselors. So this camp takes place on private property. There is a locked gate and everything. It's actually ultra eerie to be rolling up to camp at night by yourself, since you have to get out of your car twice to open and close the gate. We actually heard a cougar one night while we were locking it, coming up in at the beginning of the week, though somebody was with me that time. What makes it worse is that there are no lights or anything, so leave your headlights on. Then it's a couple miles down a gravel road. There is a small lodge rented out on weekends, so people can come and stay and go fishing, but that was only occupied when the kids' camp wasn't going on, so it was dark and empty most of the time we were there. A little past the lodge, and you hit our camp. It's a bunch of big, thick, cabin-like tents made out of canvas in a small clearing, along with our cookhouse. Surrounding the area is very, very dense woods in all directions. All in fairly remote location, pretty simple setup, and the darkest nights you could ever imagine. Beautiful stars, too. Now getting to the juicy part. It was our second night of the week, and we already had our campfire, and had all the kids brush their teeth and get into their cabins. Small note here that the bathroom is on the backside of the cookhouse, about a 30-meter walk from the closest cabin. We had a short meeting, and most of the other counselors went to the cabins they were assigned to go to bed in. Skye, who was the youngest of the counselors, was still sitting on the deck reading a book by a lantern. I walked around back to go brush my teeth, and when I came back to the deck to grab some of my things, I noticed Skye wasn't reading anymore. He was sitting right at the edge of his seat, eyes locked on the pitch-black forest. I was about to ask him what was wrong, but he shushed me before the words could even leave my mouth. He apologized in a whisper that I could barely hear and pointed down at something I couldn't see. My initial reaction was that he was messing with me, and I started to tell him it wasn't funny. Then he had me move, so my line of sight matches, and I saw it for the first time. There were these three little reflective spots deep in the trees. It was so dark, they were the first thing I noticed. "What is that?" I asked. "I don't know," Skye replied. "But they're moving. Look." Squinting around the darkness, barely able to distinguish the trees from the surrounding darkness, I could see that he was right. Only, it wasn't only the lights. Surrounding them was this massive black shape, maybe the size of a grizzly bear, but up on its hind legs. That's when I saw the lights blink, and then the whole shape move behind a large group of trees. It very much appeared that the lights rise, the way they blinked and reflected. Only there were three of them, in the shape of an equilateral triangle. At this point, Michael, who was the other CIT, came out of the men's bathroom and looks equally confused and intrigued by us pointing our flashlights out at the woods. As if on cue, we hear the most horrifying sound I've ever heard in my entire life. The only way I can describe it is like an amplified snake hiss coming out of a coyote. I was so scared I tripped over a board on the deck trying to scramble into the little cookhouse kitchen. We sat in there for almost 30 minutes, panicking and telling Michael what we saw. He thought that we might have seen some reflective tape on a sign, or a cow who escaped into a nearby field. It happens. But couldn't explain the sound. We finally got our heads on straight and went back out there to look again. We pointed our flashlights out to the spot we saw it in before, and there it was. Barely visible, just outside of the range of our lights, moving occasionally just behind a tree, only to peer out at us a moment later. At first, it seemed like it was moving closer, but it was hard to be sure. Michael saw it that time. We had all seen it. We went back into the cookhouse again. By 3:30, we had checked on it, retreated back into the cookhouse at least 4 or 5 times, because we were always so unsettled that it was just there, hadn't moved on. We even tried yelling at it at one point. It seemed like it was just waiting or watching us. I think it knew we were trying to see it, and it didn't seem to care all that much. At some point, we decided that we had to go back to the cabins we were all supposed to be in. So the plan was, we would just run as fast as we could back to the cabins without turning our heads to look into the woods. If we don't look at it, it's not there, right? It worked great. We finally got back to our beds. I was in the girls' cabin, and the other two went to the boys' one. So I'm laying there, unable to sleep, thinking about all the weird stuff we saw out there. An hour or so goes by, I still can't sleep. All of a sudden, I hear footsteps coming up through the gravel. It's this thick, crunchy, volcanic stuff that makes a lot of noise when you walk on it. The footsteps come right up to the side of the canvas tent. Literally, whatever's standing out there is standing 4 inches away from me, only separated by this thin layer of fabric. I wait for them to walk away, or come to the tent, or call out to me, or do anything, but they never walked away. Just silence. I waited another hour, maybe more. There's no way anyone could walk through that gravel without the whole campsite hearing, and I know they walked right up next to me and never walked away. I felt like I had just fallen asleep when I was woken up by some loud gunshots. They sounded close, but not right in our camp or anything. Safe to say I didn't sleep anymore that morning. That morning, I asked the guys if they had heard any of the gunshots, and they did. We also went back to go check out the spot of the woods where we saw a thing lurking around. Nothing reflective, no strange hulking items. But behind the large group of trees, there was a freshly dug pit that went straight down into Tartarus. I mean, this whole thing was like 4 feet wide and at least 10 feet deep before it looked like it turned. We didn't see any evidence of a shovel. The ground was too covered in pine needles for us to find any good prints, human or animal. We were so creeped out, we genuinely didn't know how to react after we saw that. I wish I'd taken a photo of the hole at least, but I didn't have a smartphone with a camera or anything. By the end of the week, the hole had been partially filled in. Not by any of us, I might mention. The other counselors totally made fun of us when we told them that we saw something strange. They jumped to the conclusion that we thought we saw Bigfoot or something, when in reality, I have truly no idea what we saw. I returned to that camp year after year and never saw or heard anything quite like that. Michael also returned for several years, and would refuse to keep his back turned to that particular spot in the woods that night. We talked about it a few years later, and everything he described still matches what I think I saw. I just really wish that we had an explanation.